So today I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker today, not only as a published author and known public speaker, but also as my best friend. I met Joey when I was a freshman in college, and we've been best friends since. I would say that outside of family, I don't think there's anyone, and I truly mean this, that has changed my life for the better more than Joey, and just kind of has really helped with my perspective and outlook on life. And we've also had a lot of laughs together. He came, you know, to speak with you guys today, but more importantly, to go watch the Patriots kick butt against the Chargers. So, and you know, he was, you know, gracious enough to come to Chadwick today and talk to you guys when I asked. So, I'd love to welcome Joey Mullaney.
First off, thank you, Mr.
My last name's Turner, yeah, there it is. We're close, I swear.
Your dad's Mr. Turner, you're not. Mr. Pullen, obviously, for having me. You guys have a tremendous school. I went to your prep school, high school in Massachusetts, and this school blows out the water. It's so nice here. But, so I want to talk to you today about overcoming adversity. I know you are young and you hopefully haven't experienced much adversity in your life, but it will happen. I want to talk about being ready for it. And talk about being mentally ready. Sort of touch upon it more throughout the speech, but just know, I do not mean be ready to go at all times, because you're going to have issues. That's just life. Like, no one's perfect. You're gonna have bad days, but just know that tomorrow, it's a new day, you can start over. So don't beat yourself up. So, to explain more about wanting to, I have a neurological disease called Friedreich's ataxia. Kind of states it affects your speech. So it's kind of really hard for me to say that, so I call it FA. The main symptoms is that you lose body temperature and mind control. So, I was saying this, growing up, I did walk out of the body like you all. But as you can see now, I'm no longer able to. Later on, FA brings on like pretty serious conditions like diabetes, different heart conditions, all that. Right now, there is no known cure or treatment, but, I mean, working out helps a ton. There are different activities we all can do. So, yeah, so I grew up in Massachusetts, like an hour away from Boston. I grew up one of four children. I have a twin brother named Sean. I have an older sister named Keila and an older brother named Ryan. Sean is not disabled, but Keila is. Keila has FA like me. She is turning 32 tomorrow. But she's good. But it's funny, FA is very different, me and her. I have more heart conditions than she has. Mine are more impactful, but she has diabetes, I don't. So it's very odd how it works, but overall it's pretty similar. Like, as you can see or hear, my speech is more affected. She speaks very well, but physically I've always been stronger than her. But it's different in every case. Yeah, so let's stay here. So I grew up playing sports like you all, like thinking I'm going to be at the next obviously, I wasn't, but, so we played sports where I grew up. Everyone played town sports, football, baseball, basketball, lacrosse, all that. I wasn't very good, but I thought I was good, so I was very aggressive, and it kind of worked out for a little bit, but once FA started taking its toll, it worked out. So as you see, I played sports and So after I didn't really, I was diagnosed when I was 9 years old. However, my parents didn't want to tell me until I was 13. They didn't want to tell me because my older sister, Keila, who I mentioned, also has FA. So I witnessed firsthand what she was going through. And they didn't want to tell me to scare me off, because right when they did eventually tell me, I knew what was going to happen. And it was a dark night, but it all led up to a plane sport. So at the age of, I want to say 4th grade, 5th grade, 10 years old, whatever that is, so I was playing sports and I was the best on my team. My twin and I were like the biggest, strongest, fastest, all that. And by the age of 12, 13, 2 or 3 years later, I was the worst player. I really played, didn't really get why. I didn't hit my growth spurt yet, so I said that's why, but deep down I knew something was wrong, but I didn't want to admit it through all that. But one important game came out when I was 13, in a basketball game, championship game. All my friends were the best players, so they played the entire game. And then my twin was dominant, played every game, every minute, scored all the points, all that achievement. And I didn't play once that game. And that was really upsetting. Well, because my own dad was a coach. I thought he was upset at me or whatever. So right after the game ended, I ran into my mom's car, started crying, and drove me home because I didn't get it. Why I was so bad. My dad, later that night, found out, and he just sat me down and touched me and told me I have FA. So as upsetting as it was, it all started to make sense to me, why my body is the way it is, why I'm not as good as everyone else, and all of that. And that was a dark time, especially being 13 and being told you're going to die one day. It's very, very tough, but I was able to find a way out, and like I said, I went to prep school in Massachusetts called Lawrence Academy. We actually called it LA, but you're LA. we'll say LA for now, but so I went there, I loved it. My biggest issue to my parents and my brother who went there was that no one could know I had backpack. I was so worried, so afraid. I didn't want people to know and pity me and treat me all differently. Just being like, oh, that's me, this Joey, this sick kid, almost. I wanted people to treat me as, like, Joey, the kid, thinks he's really cool, but he's not. FA, like, could hide it at first. I would say freshman year, you couldn't really notice my blocking was off balance or anything, but slowly it got worse because it is progressive, so I want to say sophomore year was pretty bad. You couldn't notice unless you're scared. Then it came junior year. Because I was trying to hide it, I was very shy, didn't really open up. People knew me, but no one really knew the real me. And certain kids at LA knew I had FA. They had to be like my bodyguards, but my junior year I got so worse that it was so obvious they couldn't do it anymore. One day we had an annual hiking trip, our entire school, and one of my friends who knew me but didn't know where FA came up to me and asked me, Joey, what's wrong? Started freaking out, and that led me to freak out, so I didn't know how to answer it. I just got all red and shoot it away. But later that night, my coach Sean, he freaked out. All of a sudden, the next day, Sean, I, and my advisor, my dean, were all called in for a meeting to discuss me in the situation now, I was going to need to inform the student body what's going on. So I did, because we had the meeting, but I was so worried that I didn't want to go on stage, I didn't want to be the ones who told people. So having this, I want to say mock assembly, that's what, and I just curious and wondering just thinking about me on stage telling the entire student body about what's going on with me, that I didn't go. My twin stepped up and said he'd do it. I wasn't even there, so I mean, it's crazy to think the biggest 15 minutes of my life wasn't there. My brother really hit me up that day. And because of that, my confidence shined. Because the kids treated me normally. They helped me out by small things like opening up doors, moving backpacks out of hallways, simple things like that that went a long way. But they all knew. Now, why I walked the way I did and being mine, or also that, the real joy started coming out. I was just much more comfortable. Yeah. So as you can see, I did a lot. It was a pretty good pressure. Yeah, so I found 2 years of high school were awesome. To give my high school graduation speech, I talked about basketball, I loved it. Yeah, so I love basketball, I love being around it, whatnot. So my head coach at the end of our senior season said, "Joey, do you want to score?" I said no, I didn't want to. But the next class, that's what I thought about. Really how, I want to say like, how the old Joey would have said no. The old Joey would have hit it and not have done it, but the new one, like, that was the time to start writing my own chapter and my own story. So I texted him just saying I'm in. One condition, I want to dunk. Yeah, he didn't believe me. He laughed, but we made it work. And I dunked the ball very much, and thank God I did, because I was getting so much positive feedback online and whatnot about it. It was huge for my strength and just overall made me a better person. I went to college with Miss Turner. So as I would say, I missed him, whatever. We met freshman year, we both joined the state fraternity, and we just immediately had a line climbing, and from there on out we were best friends. We were both senior women together our senior year. We saw a photo. He helped me hike the senior mountain we lived up to. So we're about to see from our college campus was a giant hiking mountain that everyone went. You can attest, like, almost every student hikes it. It's more of a social gathering, I would say. But obviously I would not do that. So they'd always say they want to bring me up, or I would joke around and say I want to take the helicopter up, but truthfully I didn't realize my jokes were hurting them. They were starting to realize, like, emotionally, yeah, like trying to realize that they could do that, but I cannot. So they actually organized a group with them, you know, and just what I think it's called Operation Get Joey Up the Mountain.
Yeah. We weren't that creative.
It worked though, like they had a game plan, like I think it was every 3 to 5 minutes I would be on someone's back, and then they would swap me off, and it actually worked so well. The funniest part is we hiked pretty early in the morning, because everyone assumed it would take 2 or 3 hours. You know, it took just what, like 1.5 hours?
Yeah.
Adrenaline definitely kicked in, and it was super exciting. It was a great time. And then, yeah, seniors, I already touched on a good senior. Elgin and I ran for president and vice president of our school. We competed the ticket and we won somehow. The kid I ran against still hates me. So if I go missing, start with him. We were also orientation leaders, bottom left. That was a great experience. Welcoming freshmen in school. You guys won't be there for a little bit, but you will when you're a freshman. It can be scary, obviously, so it was nice to administer them and welcome them to the chemistry room. And then, that's it for the most. Yes, I really want to preach about making the most of your time. So, as you can see, I was very non-confident in myself, and didn't believe I could do much, but now I do. Even physically, things are hard, but I had the mentality to always do it what I can. That's what I want you guys to, like, hear from us. If you're young, don't worry, you don't have to have it all figured out at all. But I want you to know, like, you're the only one stopping you. No one else, or your parents, or your friends, or anyone. It's you. So if you want to do something, go do it. Don't let fear or anything stop you. So the preface, this was like a month ago with the mayor of the town about our book and all that. It kind of summed up my attitude of life right now.
Chess player, you've got to be able to think.
Oh, yeah, you got to be used to all
time. Look up, so at 13, 14, 15, you had that gift to be able to look out ahead.
Mm-hmm.
And has that helped you? Or
Definitely helped me now. It was one of those blessings in the curse when you're younger, you know what's ahead, but you want to do the most you can before you're not able to, and that's what I'm doing now. As you can see, I'm a young kid, I'm only 26. And I wrote a book. I'm trying to do it all before I can't do it anymore.
And
yes, but quick, but that's how I just preach my life to everyone, or want to preach to you, sorry. Just go for it, do it all. You need to want to be safe, but don't be afraid to mess up, because that's how you learn, in my opinion. If you fail, that's alright. Get back on. Having mental issues, like, now I can test, like, I've had my own, but I've always known there's a new day tomorrow with this program. So if you get a fun, some of those work out, you get a bad grade on some tests, whatever it may be, just know there's definitely room to improve and make it up. Sorry, guys. Thank you.
So Joey did mention in the video, so we did publish a book in September. It's called Stare at Me. I know Mr. Pullen put it in the newsletter on Sunday for to order it. There's a Google form, so I know a few of you already have. Joey here has a few of those copies and is going to be like stamping them like his signature, which is really cool. I didn't even get that treatment, so I'm a bit jealous, but For those that got that, that's awesome. But you know, if you are interested in this book, I've read it. I only cried like 4 times, I think. But if you, it's really inspirational. It's really impactful. So Joey, thank you so much.
Growing up, being in a party and then being changing a flat grave.
Was there ever a point
that
you
thought,
I
should
still have
a hundred percent? Oh, yes, 100%. When I wouldn't say give up, but when I got to the age of 16 for human new IFA, I was very bummed out seeing my friends and kids that I go to school with, like, get their license, like, not have to worry about, like, how long it would take them to, like, get ready in the morning, brush their teeth, like, not having to worry about putting their socks on or stuff like that. And you kind of get jealous, you get upset, but think about what you do have first, what you don't have. I'm trying not to let that, like, stop you.
What was your hardest
part?
What was the, like, the hardest part, the biggest challenge?
Too many, but I would say just seeing friends and kids my age that I grew up with, seeing how easy they have it. But I was so wrong about that, like, although it would take me 10 minutes to get ready in the morning and then one, and I thought they had harder or easier, I would say. I was so wrong. The more I learned, the more I realized everyone has their own mental issues going on. Everyone does. It could be someone at home, it could be someone away, who knows. But you gotta realize that you're not.
Sophia?
Yeah.
I like your sweatshirt, but so I started first day when I was 18, the day I moved into college. I wouldn't say I was doing much walking in the summer prior. It was pretty bad, but I didn't start using this.
Up there, Cannon?
So you were diagnosed with it about, like, well, you were diagnosed at 9, but really found out and really felt it when you were, like, 10, well, when you were, like, 12, 13. Mm-hmm. We all know how, like, self-conscious we are already and how, like, hard it is to fit in. Which was harder, the academic struggles or the social struggles?
For me, social, it was just so hard, like, you know, we're high school students, we're all insecure, but... So, I mean, that was tough seeing friends, like, just wanting to be, like, an athlete, didn't know how to be cool, didn't know how to talk to people, because I always relied on being athletic, but I couldn't be anymore, so that was tough to be a social aspect. amazing superhero, Greek god. Because of that, I was able to bring all the confidence to college. And he guided me, so she knew it. God is like God, and some more friend. That's a phenomenal, yes, A plus for you. I mean, you guys know, you can test, like, when you were growing up, did your parents or guardians whoever would say, don't stare at the moment you see like a homeless person or someone in a wheelchair or someone different than you? It's about that. So, for a while, people would look and be like, don't stare, don't stare. And that would obviously get to me. So this book and this title is my way of saying, if you want to stare at me, go ahead. I don't know if you're going to love what you see, but if you want to see, go ahead. My buddy back there, he's a wizard. I will say, I'll never forget some of the parents I grew up with. So my latest thing that turned me very good sports. It was very hard with grandparents, but go to him after games, saying like, oh my God, you're amazing, good job, and almost a kill on me. I know it wasn't good, but just seeing that hurt. Alex did, yes. I will say that, yeah. He still does, he helps, like, motivates me to do more, he pushed myself, like, get outside my comfort zone, and all about that.
Thanks,
Lisa.
If you could, kind of relive your life, would you change anything?
I always say no regrets, like, it is what it is, but... Yes, I would have. Yeah.
Here's the
other
question.
Yeah, like, probably no. We'll say no.
Other than Mr. Silver or Alex, who offered you like the most support?
My twin, my buddy Rocco. His friends and family, really. My sister was me. Because she went through exactly what I did, so it's good to have her in the line.
So you
still have to call us a father? Oh, yeah. My twin actually lives with me in the same part of the day, and so my sister. And our older brother lives in New York. But, I thought it was bizarre being 23-year-old kid writing a book. I say 23 because it took me 3 or 4 years to write. Write, edit, find a book, you know, all that. I will say after high school, I was like, wow, I've already lived a pretty interesting life, maybe, but I was going to see how it went in college. And as I can test college, but very interesting. So.
Maddie, go ahead.
Kids are really smart. But yeah, that was a tough night. I didn't accept it for many years. But that night was that was a terrible night. Just falling out. I cried all night. My siblings cried with me all night. My parents cried as well. It was real tough. I was there just seeing Kayla because I already knew what she was going to do. I mean, saw her give up ballet when she loved it. She would give up basketball, she loved that. Then I saw kids. She tried to play basketball for a little bit, but then quit. She quit because from the away team she was playing, it was being fun to walk. Real bad, the girls were just teasing her, making fun of her, and she literally quit, and I just saw that, and knew. I was gonna go do stuff like that. I already got
it. Arnold, what about you?
Okay, so two questions. So my first one is, were you like upset when you found out that you found out about it until you were 13?
Yes, at first. Nowadays I understand. At first I was like, how dare you keep a secret with a lie to my parents? But nowadays, I'm more mature, I realize I was there doing it, not to be selfish or anything, but to protect me. And I mean, calling you probably tested to son and daughter. That your parents have your back no matter what. They're always going to try to look out for you. They will mess up at times, but in the long run, they're right there with you. I will say that assembly I talked about really helped get the ball rolling to accept FA. Truthfully, I still feel like I don't have it. Physically, I know I do. Obviously, I can't do as much, but emotionally, yeah. I try to live like I don't, so that it won't stop me or prevent me from doing anything I love.
All right, Brendley, go ahead.
Were you born with
FA? Yes. So, there's a whole scientific background, but yes, I was. So, I was born with it. My parents, they contain a certain missing chromosome or something like that. I don't want to butcher it, but yeah, I was. Issue was, yeah. And then, but the big issue with my twin, it was a 50-50 chance who would get it. And like I said, I got it. I physically have it, but emotionally, I would say he had it.
Great question, guys.
Yeah,
thank you so much.
Amazing question, you guys. Folks know in the newsletter there's a link where you can go to buy the book. There's so much more to his stories, you know, than just what he was able to kind of give you a little bit of today. I've been a lot to learn from his life experience. There's also a link in the newsletter to his website, so you can learn more about that. That's pretty much it. Mm-hmm. Anything else?
No, but thank you guys. Enjoy your way of life. That's why you can go outside right now. We're from, that's not our option, so enjoy it.
Awesome. Thank you. Chloe, thank you. Benjamin, Peyton, Sophia Caviani, Emma Landsberg, and Carrie, hang on a second. Everybody else, we want to start slowly. We'll go from the back of the room.